For those who remember. For those who will never forget. And for a whole new generation who will experience it for the very first time. The Star Wars Trilogy. Three timeless adventures that changed movie making forever. Now the entire trilogy, digitally mastered in THX for the ultimate in sound and picture quality. This will be your last chance to own the original version of Star Wars, the George Lucas masterpiece that launched the Star Wars trilogy. The Force is forever, for all generations. The original Star Wars trilogy on video, one last time.
Hello, I'm Leonard Maltin. When you've made a film that is not only extraordinarily successful, but has embedded itself in our popular culture, well, that's a tough act to follow. But George Lucas managed to pull it off. After Star Wars came The Empire Strikes Back, a totally successful film in its own right, as well as one of the most popular sequels ever made. And he's here today to tell us a little about the genesis of that film and its place in the Star Wars trilogy. Thanks for being here, George.
Thank you.
Star Wars has come out. A success, I think it's fair to say, beyond your expectations.
Yeah, definitely.
At what point did you receive a commitment or an urging to do a sequel? And did you immediately say yes, or was there any hesitation on your part to do it?
Well, it didn't really happen that way, because what I did when I was writing it, I wrote one movie, and then I couldn't do the whole movie, because it was way too big. The first draft was, you know, it had too much stuff in it. It was way too big. It couldn't possibly be done. So I took a deep breath and said, okay, I'm going to have to take all these great ideas, and that part I'm just going to have to cut out, and I'll just do what it was then really the first act, and I'll expand this and make this into a movie. So I did that, but then as a writer, you know, you create this whole thing, and it's, you know, sitting there on the shelf. So as soon as the film was successful, there wasn't any question in my mind that I would immediately go on and do the rest of them so I could finish it.
What to you is the biggest difference, overall difference, between film number one and film number two?
Well, the biggest problem I was grappling with in film number two is the fact that it's the middle act of a three-act play.
Now, some people find it a darker film than the first.
It is a darker film because in the first act you introduce everybody. The second act, you put them in the worst possible position they can ever get into in their lives, and it's and they're in a black hole, never able to get out. And in the third act, they get out. That's just, again, that's drama. That's the way it works. You don't have an exuberant, happy second act.
What was the biggest technological advance between the making of one and the making of two?
Well, there wasn't really too much of a technological. We refined what we had primarily, but there wasn't any giant technology. The major technological break was in one, and that was using motion control cameras and that sort of thing to allow the ships to be able to move freely and that sort of thing. That was the big advance. Everything after that was we were able to do more stop motion. I was able to do a lot more things. They weren't really technological advances, but I was able to get a lot more into stop motion, which I couldn't do before, and generally have a bigger scope to things than I could do before. So if the first film was a technological challenge to get ships to fly in space with a lot of that movement, the second one was to do a stop-motion movie.
How did you choose or get together with Frank Oz to be Yoda?
When I created Yoda, I said I want him to be really, really small, but not, 6 feet. I want him, be about 18 inches, 2 feet high. And to do that, I said, well, what am I going to do? And how am I going to get a character? And what am I going to do? Whenever I'm creating one of these films, I have my imagination. And if I were a novelist, I could just write it, and I wouldn't have to think about it. But I write it, and then I say, well, now how am I going to do this? You know, how am I going to pull this off? And I decided to do it as a puppet. I thought that was the best. And so I'd known Jim Henson, and I went to Jim and said, you know, do you want to do this? Because I really asked Jim to do it first. And he said, well, I'm busy. I'm doing this. I'm doing that. And I'm making a movie and all, and I really can't. But how about, you know, Frank? You know, Frank's the other half of me and everything. And I said, well, that would be fantastic.
It's an extraordinary creation.
I think it was exciting for everybody because it was the idea of taking, and Jim was very interested in doing realistic characters, you know, that weren't really Muppets. And so we all really worked together on it.
Tell me about how you first met and worked with John Williams.
I had known Steven Spielberg for a long time up to this point. And, you know, we were talking about the film real early on when I was writing the script. And I said, I want a classical score. I want the Korngold kind of feel about this thing. It's an old-fashioned kind of movie, and I want that grand soundtrack that it used to have on movies. And he said, the guy you got to talk to is John Williams. You know, he did Jaws. I love him. He's the greatest composer ever lived. You got to talk to him. And so I did. I mean, it was really Steven that introduced us and recommended him. And, you know, I talked to him and said, okay. And he was interested. So he did it. And he's a dream to work with. You know, he's a most wonderful collaborator.
Didn't you at first want him to use existing classical music? Is that true?
No. I had written it to certain pieces of music. I write to music. So when I'm writing a scene, I have the music there, and I'm writing it to the music. And then, in a lot of cases, we'll use that same music as a temp track. So there was temp tracks of classical music in the score. And with Johnny, you can say, look, I want something that feels exactly like this. You know, you understand the emotion here and the emotion there and what's going on. He said, yeah. And then he will take that and he will come up with his own composition and his own themes, which are uniquely, you know, Star Wars themes in this case. But he'll give it that same emotional thrust that was in the classical piece. He knows exactly what I'm talking about, and he's really conscientious in trying to get the director's vision on the screen.
What kind of feedback did you get to that incredible climactic scene in Empire when we all learn who Darth Vader really is?
I was nervous about it, but in the end, I didn't get much of a reaction out of it. I mean, people, you know, were curious about whether it was true or not. And I purposely left it so that it would be ambiguous, so that you wouldn't really know, and people would sort of debate it for the next week. Again, I had two more years or more to, you know, I wanted people to sort of debate whether it's true or not true, or like sort of thing.
Well, George, as you know, people are just nuts for these movies, and to learn so much about them and what went into them and what inspired you is a real treat.
No, thank you. It's fun. I hope that people continue to enjoy the films because it's nice to think of them as being timeless.
And now, our feature presentations.